Good morning to all of you who are here in person or joining us online. If you are on Facebook, we know that we are having technical issues and invite you to come to our uchurch.org website so that you can watch our live streaming. Facebook is not working this morning, so our website is working, and we hope you will join us there. Our call to worship is for Thanksgiving and reads, "Oh, give thanks to God, for God is good. God's steadfast love endures forever. Let us give thanks for God's steadfast love, for God's wonderful works. For God satisfies the hungry and fills the thirsty with good things. Let the peoples praise you, O God. Let all the people praise you." Our choir is going to lead us in singing, "We Gather Together." For those who are here, we'll just watch the choir sing, and for those of you at home, feel free to sing. The bulletin is posted on Facebook and on our website.
Technical issues this morning, aren't we, Eddie? Yeah, sometimes it happens. For some reason, that song just finished, which means that we're going to put it out on the website. And if people want to hear the whole thing, they can go out later and hear the whole thing. Hi, good morning. How are you?
Good.
You have some new color in your hair, don't you? That is great. That's really pretty. Yeah, all different colors, and you got a haircut. Looks great. And a special welcome to everybody watching from home. We're delighted that you're with us. Hey, Addie waved. Yahoo. So what happens when we get sick?
You stay home.
You don't feel good. But what does a grown-up maybe do for you? What do they maybe go out and get?
Medicine.
Good medicine can make us feel better. Sometimes it's as simple as an aspirin or some Tylenol or a little cough syrup. Yeah? And mix up some medicine? Yeah. Oh, okay. Well, what I want to talk about today is a different kind of medicine. So I think we're all kind of sick. And let me explain what I mean by that. The grown-ups are not behaving very well. We're fighting with each other, we're arguing, we're mad. Half and half, it seems like, and we're going like this, doesn't it? Just back and forth, and it's just not a pleasant time. I think that our social discourse, the way we talk to each other, and the way we treat each other, is sick. But you know what I think is good medicine for us? I think the holidays are good medicine, especially starting off here with Thanksgiving. Yeah?
I actually think kindness is medicine.
What about the medicine?
I actually think
kindness is medicine. Kindness is some of the best medicine, absolutely. Yesterday, we put up a bunch of holiday decorations at my house, a whole bunch of Christmas decorations, and it did my heart so good to do that. And it makes me feel better. It reminds me of previous Christmases. Sunday, I think, is good medicine. Coming here or watching us on your website or on your computer somehow. But holidays are great medicine. Decorations are good medicine. They remind us of a number of things. They remind us of the goodness of our past holidays, but I think they also remind us of the goodness of the time to come. And something that they really remind us of is this. We are all human beings, everybody, and we are all one people, and we live on one planet, and we've got to learn to get along. And also then, for our little tribe here in America, we are all Americans first. And then after that, we can go and divide down into Democrats and Republicans and Independents and Libertarians and all those divisions. But we are all Americans. And that means that we have agreed to live together under a specific set of rules. We call that the Constitution. And then there are laws that are based on that. Then there's another division that we're all in this room, most of us, and that is Christians. And that means that we have chosen to follow the teachings of Jesus and believe that Jesus and Jesus the Christ give us a different way to live in the world. And the two biggest things we do in regard to being a Christian is we love God and we love our neighbor. Yeah.
My grandma is probably watching.
Uh-huh. Hi, Grandma. Addie's grandma is watching. Now, this is one last little thing to talk about in all of this, but it's important because we're celebrating Thanksgiving this week. And Thanksgiving is a big deal for our flavor of Christian. We are called Congregationalists, and we are actually the type of religion that came over on the Mayflower. And they spent 60-some-odd days out at sea, and it was really difficult to get here. I'll talk more about that later, but the most important thing I like to share about being a Congregationalist is this. And believe it or not, the Congregationalists taught the other early colonists how to do this. That is, you are guaranteed to get to have your say. In Congregationalism, everybody gets to raise their hand and be heard. And that's really, really important. Now, that doesn't guarantee that you're going to get your way, but you get to have your say. So all of that working backwards, Congregationalists, right? Christians, right? Americans, right? Human beings. What's at the top of that? We're all humans. We're all in this together. And the grown-ups better learn how to get along, right? I hear you. Thank you for being here. Thanks for watching, and we'll see you next week. Bye.
So much to be it's way too late to say I'll cry tomorrow. Each of us must find our truth. It's so long overdue. So for tonight we what we know can be, and every day we hope for what we still can't see. It's up to us to be the change, and even though we all can still do more. There's so much to be thankful for. Even with our differences, there is a place we're all connected. Each of us can find each other's love.
Thank you so much, Renee. Beautiful song of thankfulness and gratitude. We're delighted that you've joined us. Hopefully you made your way over to UCChurch.org if you are on Facebook, and we apologize for that. We'll try to find out what the issue is and get that fixed as soon as we can. A couple joys. One big one, Valerie's back. She's up there, yay, doing her thing, and of course, she came back to a broken Facebook, but we'll, like I said, get it fixed. Our other joy this coming Thursday is Dick and Gail Pilgrim's 54th wedding anniversary, and they graciously provided the flowers on the communion table this morning in honor of that event. How, shall I say, perfect that Pilgrims are celebrating their anniversary on Thanksgiving this year. Congratulations, you two, and we wish you many, many more years together. As we move into our time of prayer, I would ask that our friend Galen Minks passed away Friday night. He fought a valiant battle with cancer for many years, and I would ask that you pray for Galen's family, for Mark, the neighborhood that has surrounded Mark with love, and this church that will continue to provide support and love for Mark in the coming days. Please hear now the words of this prayer. Loving Creator, as I prepare to go out into the world each day, help me see the sacrament in the wearing of the cloth, my mask. Let it be an outward sign of an inward grace, a tangible and visible way of a living love that I have for my neighbors as I love myself.
Loving Jesus, since my lips will be covered, uncover my heart, so that people might see my smile and the crinkles around my eyes. Since my voice may be muffled, help me to speak clearly, not only with my words, but with my actions. Loving Spirit, as the elastic touches my ears, remind me to listen carefully and full of care to all those I meet. May that simple piece of cloth be shield and banner, and each breath that it holds be filled with your love. In your name and in that love, I pray, may it be so. May it be so. Amen. A few announcements. Christmas poinsettias are going to be up here again on the chancel this year. If you would like to contribute to our Christmas poinsettia display, please send a check for $15 to the church, payable to University Congregational. Please do that by December 4th. You're welcome to drop it by as well. Be sure to write flowers on the memo line and indicate if your donation is in honor of or in memory of someone special. I and Robin and Val and Heidi are calling for pictures. We are requesting all of our members and our friends to send us a photo that we can share during our virtual Christmas Eve service for this year. We're putting together a montage that'll be played during the closing song of Silent Night. So we would love everyone to participate in this. We put the call out this week. I think I've received 5 pictures so far. We have a little ways to go. Please send a digital photo to me, paul@uchurch.org. Now, ideally, we would have the family out in front of your door holding candles, a candle or each candle, however you want to stage that. But we also understand that not everyone can do that. If you can do that, stand in front of your door, send us that picture. That would be great. If not, please send us a family picture or even just a picture of you yourself, regardless of where you decide to stage it. We really would like to have 100% participation in this event. We haven't seen each other. I was cleaning up some piles in the living room yesterday, making space for our Christmas tree, and I came across an old bulletin, and it was from March the 8th. March the 8th, and that was the last time that we, 150 of us, were in this room for worship. I'm going to frame that bulletin, and next to it, I'm going to frame the bulletin of the first big return that hopefully will be coming soon. So send me that picture or give me a call or email me if you need more information. So the Angel Tree, the UCC Outreach Board is once again partnering with Starkey this year so that adults with developmental disabilities can have gifts this Christmas. We are also partnering with the Wichita Children's Home and the Gutierrez family again this year. Our need for these people, the need is great. And we have a combined total of 100 Angel Tree tags this year. So we're asking for this church's and this community's assistance so that we can provide the gifts to each child and each adult that is in need this Christmas. Now, since many of us are staying home and not getting out, Heidi and Emily have been working very hard to be able to email the tags to you, or we could probably even snail mail it if you'd prefer that. If you would like your tag in a different manner, call Heidi at the church office, and she'll make sure that happens. Also, the gifts may be dropped off here at the office Monday through Friday from 9 to 3, and we're accepting monetary donations, and we can do your shopping for you. We've had a couple people ask us to do that. Now, the office hours will be weird this week because the office is closed Thursday and Friday for the Thanksgiving holiday. So if you're going to do that, do it before Wednesday. Humankind Operation Holiday Collection. This is also another important project that we are involved with in our community. We're accepting donations of non-perishable food, new children's coats, new or newly handmade children's winter accessories and blankets. So please bring a new full or queen-size blankets and children's coats to the Operation Holiday boxes, and we put them right outside of the office doors Monday through Friday, 9 to 3, and that is happening now. We need that. Hopefully you can get that done this week. Robin was sharing with me that the need is incredibly great. Did you say 6,000?
6,000 children.
6,000 children that humankind is helping this Christmas season. Robin has shared with me her plans, and I know Dwayne and I will go and buy some coats as well and bring them in for this event. It sounds like coats are one of the biggest things that they will need. The Christian Life for Sunday, November 22nd, 2020. I found it fitting to use our National Association of Congregational Christian Churches Thanksgiving Proclamation, which they send out every year about this time. And I wanted to use that as our Christian Life for this Sunday morning. This year's proclamation was written by the Reverend Dr. Sean Stapleton. On October 3rd, 1789, President George Washington issued the first Thanksgiving Proclamation, within it saying this: "It is the duty of all nations to acknowledge the providence of Almighty God, to obey God's will, to be grateful for God's benefits, and humbly to implore God's protection and favor." While that statement is perpetually and perennially true, it seems more true than ever in our 2020. It was 400 years ago this month, several generations before General Washington's declaration of a national day of Thanksgiving, that our spiritual and ecclesiastical foreparents stepped off the Mayflower onto the shores of Cape Cod after 66 harrowing days at sea. Conditions were challenging, to say the least, and they lost many of the family and friends with whom they had left the shores of Europe. With the help of the indigenous Wampanoag people, the people with whom they might have had an immediate conflict, the pilgrims were able to eventually plant and harvest sustainable crops and to withstand the harsh climate of the New England shores. Today, we are not unlike those pilgrims. We have settled in uncharted territory. We have lost many family and friends. We need to band together to get through these challenges. So with those things in mind, let us give thanks. Thanks for every breath, which is a gift from God. Thanks for every moment together, knowing that the next is not assured. Thanks for every provision God supplies, no matter how meager. Thanks for every member of this community and of our support systems, without which we could not survive. May God grant all of us the courage, the grace, the strength, the faith, and the tenacity to forge ahead as we face whatever challenges might lay before us. With Jesus as our teacher and the Holy Spirit as our guide, we can march with confidence into the coming days. May the blessings of God be with all of us this holiday season.
Thank you.
So in the wake of an unprecedented worldwide pandemic, many of us have felt the weight and additional stress of uncertainty in our daily lives. For some of you, maybe that was the understatement of the week. Some families are experiencing way too much togetherness, while others are wondering if we'll ever be able to get back together. There are young people who are tired of learning long distance, and college-age students and perhaps middle and high school students are yearning to get back to the classroom with their mentors. Family gatherings for the holidays are put on hold across the country. Medical professionals are aching for a vaccine, and yet they're so tired that they hope and pray their particular clinic is not chosen to provide those vaccines. We all want to travel, but we're afraid to risk it and don't know when we will be able to feel comfortable even after a vaccine is available. We're stuck in this pandemic and the future. We're living through unusual and trying times. The COVID-19 pandemic has people feeling stressed and frightened. And that's why it's important, perhaps more than ever, to focus on gratitude. The practice of noticing and being thankful for what is valuable and meaningful to you. It is important, critical for our mental and physical health. It can help us relax, and its effects can help us stay well through the coronavirus pandemic and beyond. So giving thanks is one of the oldest concepts in our society, with the practices at the core of more wisdom traditions and religions than perhaps any other practice. In Judaism, for example, sacrificial traditions of thanksgiving offerings are found in the first chapters of the Torah, and blessings are recited numerous times daily, including before and after meals. In Christianity, the Eucharist itself means thanksgiving. Bread and wine serve as symbols of
gratitude. The holiday of Thanksgiving that we celebrate this week is centered, of course, on gratitude. Robert Emmons, a psychologist and world expert on gratitude, defines gratitude as recognizing goodness in our lives, which we often take for granted. It's frequently due to the actions of someone else. When grateful, we identify and appreciate the intention and effort that's involved in the actions given on our behalf and the benefits generated. We each express gratitude toward other people in a variety of ways. Before COVID, we could offer a handshake, a pat on the back, a hug when it was socially acceptable or appropriate, in addition to the more common direct verbal or written forms of communication. But now, in a pandemic where we socially distance, there are different ways of expressing appreciation, a shout out on a Zoom work meeting, or a thumbs up, or a heart emoji, a retweet, a daily or weekly email to our friends, inclusive of wins or achievements, a monthly award for a star colleague who went above and beyond in their duties or patient care. But however we express it, research demonstrates that these small gestures, even a thumbs up on Facebook, can result in tremendous impact on well-being. While we can impact others by expressing our gratitude directly, we can actually help ourselves feel better by articulating gratitude in written or spoken form, even if we speak that gratitude to ourselves, which allows us to focus on the moment and what makes us feel joy or happiness or satisfaction. During crisis like pandemics, a grateful perspective is critical to sustain our own positive attitude. It brings us healing and energy and even hope. So focusing on silver linings, counting our blessings, stopping to smell the roses, these aren't just cliches, they're actual activities that research shows enhance our quality of life. And the health benefits of practicing gratitude are wide-ranging and maybe even a bit surprising. Rather than watching the national news or discussing headlines of the local paper, what if we all took time, especially this week, to be grateful for the world that we have discovered as part of our quarantine or working from home? What if we paused to appreciate the opportunities we have that we've maybe taken for granted and reestablished some of the old traditions and spent some more time together within those little circles that we've reestablished, that we live in now? Over the past few months, do you know that jigsaw puzzles, bikes, free weights, board games have actually sold out in stores because we've started to work on personal fitness and we've created more intimate circles in our homes and explored these old things and brought them back into our lives? Instead of rushing off to bigger activities and sporting events, we have cooked more dinners at home and tried more recipes and enjoyed movie nights with our families and found our way back to each other in smaller groups. So in these times of quiet, we've come back to some of the older things that we used to do, taking walks in our neighborhoods, reconnecting with our neighbors, sitting outside, reading more books, looking at the night sky. We've been reaching out to grandchildren and grandparents and older family members, teaching them how to Zoom or FaceTime so that we can maintain close relationships while staying safely apart. Eric and I this week got to see our granddaughter take her first steps on FaceTime, and I've bored everyone that I've come in contact with that video and that FaceTime, just to brag on her a little bit. And now we're no longer too busy to color and paint and mail birthday cards or handwritten notes to family and friends. Some of us have explored new hobbies and talents, while others make phone calls to friends that maybe we didn't before. According to Harvard Publishing, gratitude is thankful appreciation for what an individual receives, whether it's tangible or intangible. And with gratitude, people acknowledge the goodness in their lives. In the process, we usually recognize that source of goodness lies at least partially outside of us. And as a result, gratitude helps us connect to something larger than ourselves as individuals, whether it's other people or nature or some sort of higher power. Now, here's where I need to make a sort of a confession. I started this sermon on gratitude early in the week with the best of intentions. And then I had to let it sit for several days. Okay, all the way till this morning. Because it seemed inauthentic. I really didn't want to preach about Thanksgiving or gratitude at all. Because frankly, I am tired of this pandemic and what it's done to our nation. And I'm angry that it has been polarizing and politicized. And then this week, my daughter's wedding in 2 short weeks in Kansas City, which was scheduled for more than a year, has had to change venues and states from Missouri to Kansas because of the limitations that were put in place this week of gatherings for people. And this week, my dear friend, and some of you know, but Galen has been my friend for 30 years. He died way too young, and I grieve for his husband, Mark. And this week, I had to uninvite the 4 people who were coming to my house for Thanksgiving because of risk exposure, including my mom. And this week I found out that, as Paul mentioned, 6,000 children in Wichita have applied for Operation Holiday, and many of them will go away without a winter coat. And other things happened this week that just didn't seem like I wanted to write a sermon about gratitude. Maybe you're with me. You're having a difficult time focusing on gratitude because of grief or circumstance or heartache. And then our traditional word for today came to me. The Apostle Paul writes to this church at Philippi, and he's writing from prison. He'd been in prison for some time, and the church had sent some gifts for him. Paul thanks the church for the gifts. But in his letter, he tells them, although he's thankful for the gifts, he really wanted to point out to them how to distinguish between the things that truly matter, not the gifts, and those that do matter. His imprisonment, serious as it was, belonged to the lesser concerns. He writes, because he's joyful, which matters more. The larger and more important issue, he writes, is that he's grateful for the growing numbers of people coming to faith. And this is what he writes to the church from Philippians 4. I know how to be brought low, and I know how to abound. In any and every circumstance, I have learned the secret of facing plenty and hunger, abundance and need. I can do all things through him who strengthens me. When I read these words, I thought about what truly matters this Thanksgiving with all that we're going through in this pandemic. Instead of focusing on the negativity that I was thinking about, it occurred to me that perhaps all of us need to take time to be grateful for what we have gained after being forced to slow down and spend time with those who are most important to us. Deepak Chopra says that shifting our perspective is a way to address the drastic life changes that have come with this pandemic. Or as he puts it, every adversity is an opportunity in disguise. He points out that the current state of the world has had a positive effect on many environmental issues that practice, like social distancing, are opportunities to connect with our inner selves and others in ways we would not have considered otherwise. And I quote, "When we come out of this, I hope that we are more collectively in the direction where we don't see the pandemic as a curse, but as an opportunity to reverse climate change, help sustainability, create a world with more peace, social and economic justice, healthier and happier and more joyful." Wow. So, I would challenge you this week of Thanksgiving to do three things. Each day, starting today, I would ask you to think of three S words: see, say, and savor. See, say, and savor. See something good around you each day. See something good around you each day. Say something of gratitude each day aloud. Savor the reasons you have to be grateful. See something good around you each day. Say something aloud of gratitude. Savor the reasons you have to be grateful. See, say, savor. If you didn't get those written down or committed to memory, you can always come back to our website and look at the end of this sermon to connect those again. See, say, savor. Tonight at dinner, as you think about the events of this day, challenge yourself or the people with whom you eat to share one aspect of the day that you or they are grateful for. See, say, and savor. Then ask what COVID-19 has taught you or them to appreciate. You will be surprised how much there is in the middle of this year to be grateful for. Karen Combs shared, a month ago or so on her Facebook page, that if this year were an ice cream truck, it would not be delivering ice cream, but rather liver and onions. And I had to laugh, and I've remembered it ever since. Now, I happen to like liver and onions, but you have to think about that, because so much has gone wrong this year. Liver and onions delivered around instead of ice cream. And yet there is so much to see, say, and savor. So that's my challenge to you this week of Thanksgiving. Whenever you pray, however you pray, whether it's at mealtime or as you get up in the morning or as you say and reflect upon the day in the evening, take a moment to see something good around you, to say something of gratitude aloud, and to savor something from the day for which you are grateful. Amen.